Well, good morning to everybody. It's a pleasure for me to be here and to have the opportunity to tell you a few things about volcanoes. I have to thank Carlo and Francesco for giving me this opportunity. So this the outline of my talk is here. I will just introduce a few concepts very shortly about volcanoes on Earth and give a few numbers. And then I will just give you a few information about volcanic hazard. Most of this you will know, I think, but just to remember what we are talking about. Then I will move to volcano monitoring from the ground first, and then volcano monitoring from space. And here there will be four items. One is deformation issues, and then plume, thermal mapping of volcanoes, and then we will go to higher feature, to the impact of volcanoes in the stratosphere. So there are many active volcanoes in the world, about 1,500 edifices around the Earth are considered to be active volcanoes, but not all those edifices are active at the same time. And if you take the present time, perhaps 60 or 70 or 80 volcanoes are active today. And in the next slides, we will see a few examples of recent activity on volcanoes. Of course, those volcanoes are not distributed everywhere on Earth, and many of them are located at the boundary of tectonic plates. For example, you see that you have a lot of volcanoes around the Pacific plate, for example. Sometimes you also have volcanoes inside the plates, like in Hawaii or in La Réunion Island here. It's a different type of volcanism, not anymore a volcanism at the limit of two plates, but inside the plate. And it's what we call hotspot volcanoes, with heat coming from very deep location in the mantle and going up like this. Now, about 10% of the world population is located near volcanoes, so is exposed to volcanic hazard. So it's not a small number. And this is not without talking about the possible impact of volcanism on air traffic. If you take this place of Earth, here, this is the Bering Strait, and here we are in Alaska and Russia. And here, every year, you have 100,000 airplanes flying over this part of the world. And in the same place, you have several ten of volcanoes, and several of them are active at the moment. And later in this talk, I will show you recent observations at a volcano very close to, located very close to Anchorage. It's a redapt volcano, and you will see that this volcano is a problem for the, not only for the city of Anchorage, which is close, but also for the air traffic. So we move now to volcanic hazard. I will show you just four slides, trying to distinguish the between the four different categories of hazard. So perhaps the most common one is the lava flow. So we all know that volcanoes produce lava flows in many, many volcanoes. And this is an example from Sicily. And here you have this painting of the 1669 eruption of Etna, which started here close to a village called Nicolosi, and that destroyed part of the city of Catania. So what we know about the lava flow is that they produce irreversible damage to the land, of course. And but in general, the velocity of the flow is slow, except in some rare case, like in Nyiragongo volcano in 1977. There was an eruption with very fast lava flow that killed people. But in general, it's not the case. You have when there is a lava flow, you have time to escape. And then, of course, the flow, the speed of the lava will depend on the slope. It will depend of the effusion rate. And of course, it will depend of the direction of the eruption. Now, if we are moving to other kind of volcano, to volcanoes where the magma is more viscous, so less fluid, we can have a different type of activity with which is more explosive activity. There are many volcanoes like that. For example, Mount St. Helens in the US or Merapi volcano in Indonesia. And in general, at those volcanoes, if you go at on the top of the volcano during an activity, you will find what the so-called lava dome, which is just the top of the lava conduit, and which will grow, and after some time, perhaps explode, and produce this type of phenomena, which is called pyroclastic flow. So in the case of a pyroclastic flow, it's different from a lava flow. It's a very fast phenomena once it is started. So perhaps it will take weeks or months for a lava dome to increase, to grow and to explode. But then when the explosion starts, the phenomena is very fast. Typically, the speed of the ash and rock in a pyroclastic flow can be of 200, 300 kilometers per hour. So you have no time to escape in case of such phenomena. And this is the result, for example, in the case of Soufrière Hills in Montserrat, it's in the Antilles volcanoes, with destructions of here, destruction of the city of Plymouth. So during a pyroclastic flow, part of the material is moving very fast down slope around the volcano. And part of the material will flow at a larger distance from the volcano. So the lightest particle will go in the higher atmosphere or in the stratosphere and go at larger distances. So what you can get as impact for the population is a ash fall at distances of sometimes 100 kilometers or a few tens of kilometers from the volcano. And this was the case, for example, during the Pinatubo eruption in the Philippines in 1992. And what you see here is roof collapses at villages located around the Pinatubo volcano. Sometimes, also, when you have a glacier on the volcano, then the ice can melt. The melting of ice can trigger a mud flow around the volcano. And this is what occurred in the Nevado del Ruiz volcano in Colombia in 1985. And here, there was a city called Armero, and 20,000 people were killed by the mud flow produced by the ice melting at the top of the volcano. When a mud flow occurs, then the thickness of the flow can be several meters, several tens of meters. And this is the situation after a mud flow near Pinatubo volcano in the Philippines. So you see that we just see the roof of the houses. Now, the volcanoes also produce gas. Here you see the volcanic plume of Sakurajima volcano in Japan. Here you see gas released at the Soufrière of Guadeloupe volcano. Sometimes this gas can be useful. For example, it can be useful for the vegetation around the volcano and but sometimes it's dangerous. And in the case of Lake Nyos in Cameroon, I think it was in 1985, there was a CO2 trapped at the bottom of this lake, and the amount of CO2 progressively increased, and then suddenly there was a sudden release of CO2 at this volcano, at this lake, that flowed around the volcano and killed several tens of people around the volcano. The biggest eruptions, we will see two examples at the end of this talk. When the eruptions are very big, they can produce also impact on the climate. We will see this later. So before going to space, I would like to present a few techniques that are used in the ground for volcano monitoring. The most important technique to monitor volcano is the seismicity. This is very clear. If you give me 10 euros to monitor a volcano, I will put a seismometer. Maybe I need more to do that, but it's important to start with the seismometer. Once you have a seismometer or more seismometers installed on the volcano, you can get this kind of information. So you will be able to see earthquakes on the volcano, small earthquakes, bigger earthquakes, and this is the signal you get when an eruption has started. So this is an example from Piton de la Fournaise volcano, where in a day when an eruption started. So you have two periods. One is before the eruption with small earthquakes and then bigger earthquakes, then more quiet period, and then this kind of signal, which is called volcanic tremor. So then when the eruption starts, the ground is moving all the time. There are also different kinds of seismometers, and in my laboratory, and in many other laboratories in the world, the scientists have developed other kinds of instruments like strain meters or tilt meters. For example, the tilt meters are designed to measure the very small tilt of the ground, and this device here can detect 1 millimeter of tilt at 1 kilometer distance. So it's very sensitive instrument. Now, we are moving slowly to ground deformation. From the tilt, we move to different techniques that have developed a lot in the last 20 years with the new technologies in ground and also in space. So this is what we were doing 15 years ago at Piton de la Fournaise volcano. With the development of new geodimeters, we were able to install and operate a device like that. And this instrument was measuring automatically the distance from here to about 20 reflectors located on the volcano. So as Andreas said before, it's good to have this, but when it is cloudy, you lose the information. This is why progressively when the GPS appeared, so here we moved to space, even if we are in ground, we are using space, we moved to GPS to monitor the ground deformation at Piton de la Fournaise with two kinds of way of using GPS. One is here, it's the measurement, here we are measuring a point, which is here near the white rectangle. You have a small nail, and we measure the coordinate of this nail with something like 1 centimeter accuracy. And then after 1 month or so, we will go back to that point and remeasure. And in this way, we will estimate the ground motion. And the second way to use GPS is to say, OK, I will leave my instrument 24 hours in the field, and it will become a permanent station, and I will get a continuous recording of the coordinate. And this is the situation here. So this GPS station is a permanent station located at the top of the Piton de la Fournaise here. And here you have 1 day of data during the start of the eruption I have seen before. And the scale here is something like 20 centimeters. And you see nothing, almost nothing. And then you see a jump. And this corresponds to the start of the eruption, to the when the magma is traveling from the magma chamber, which is at something like 2 kilometer depth at Piton de la Fournaise, towards the surface. So magma is traveling from the magma chamber toward the surface. It takes half an hour or so for that. And then you see that the deformation goes back. This is because during the magma intrusion, you have a large overpressure. And then when the magma, when the lava flow is starting, the pressure drops a little bit because it start, the flow has started. So and we see this very well in the GPS data. Now, the volcanoes produce gas. I already told you before. We can measure this gas from the ground. And there are a lot of species of gas. You can do many things with gas measurements. There are many instruments for that. Here, it's some kind of observation which is made in many volcanoes. We just sample gas in a fissure and then do the analysis afterward in the laboratory. So we go back with the sample in the lab and analyze the sample later on. This is more or less the same thing, but what we measure here, we are taking small particles, small aerosols from the volcano, from Stromboli, and then because the objective was to analyze the radioactive decay of a very short-lived radionuclide of radon, we were supposed to send the samples within 2 days to Carlo lab in Gif-sur-Yvette for doing the analysis. This here is a different kind of observation. We are using at the ground an instrument which is not very different to what I will show you from space later. It's an instrument designed to monitor the attenuation of two ultraviolet frequencies in the volcanic plume here, and two frequencies that are sensitive to the content in sulfur dioxide. So moving the instrument from this side to the volcano to the other side, you cross the volcanic plume, and when you cross the plume, the signal measured by the instrument increases because here inside the plume you get a lot of sulfur dioxide and the instrument is sensitive to this gas. And later on I will show you exactly the same technique used from satellite. Of course, when there is a lava flow, when there is this kind of phenomena, a lava fountain, perhaps we want to study the phenomena. And sometimes you can do very simple things. And this is what I did several years ago in Stromboli. I went there with my camera, and I made a photo, simple photo. And I found that two things in my photo. First is looking at one photo, and then at the one collected, the 1 second after, and 2 seconds, 3 seconds after, I was able to see this stone moving down slope. So I was able to measure the speed of the flow. And in the same way you have seen before with the satellite data, I was able to see that there was a difference in speed between the center of the lava flow and the edges of the lava flow. In fact, the theory says that for this kind of flow, the speed of the flow is a parabola with zero velocity at both edges and maximum velocity at the center. And the reason why you see black at the center is exactly that. At the center, the velocity is maximum and stable. So the rocks at the center, they don't need to rotate. It's a very steady part of the lava flow, while the two edges, they have differential velocities, so the rocks move. So the red appears all the time. Okay, and the second thing, when in my photo, I found that the red was not the same everywhere. So here it was very red, and then it was decreasing. So I thought that perhaps I could make some simple analysis of the color, converting the color into temperature. And this is what I did. And here you have a very preliminary, but perhaps not so bad, estimate of the temperature decay in the first 10 of meter from the vent to here. So the distance from here to here is maybe 300 meters. And what you see here is an estimate, just using a photo, of the decay of the temperature from here to here. So on volcanoes, you can do simple things from ground, and you can do simple things from space. Here, it's a different story. The instrument you see here is a Doppler radar. So it's in this case, it's it's the same as the more or less the same as the radar of the police, and we are measuring the speed of the rocks that are exploding here in this lava fountain. So with this device, we can monitor very accurately the lava fountain. Okay, now we move to the center of my talk, to the volcano monitoring from space. And as I said before, there will be four parts in this in the story. And I would like to start with this. I think that we need to understand what we do with the satellites and with the sensors. We have to remember where we are in the electromagnetic spectrum. So in the previous talk, we have seen data in the visible band here, and then we moved to the radio wave, to the radar here. So it will be the same for the volcanoes. But in fact, we have very little choice because the atmosphere is not transparent everywhere. It is transparent here in the visible. It is transparent here in the radio frequency. And it is partly transparent here and here. In the previous talk, you have seen that in the infrared domain, just some bands are transparent and others are not. So I will show you what we do in radar interferometry. So you will see fringes, like you have seen before. Then I will move to infrared spectrometry on the volcano. So we will be start in the thermal infrared and reach the visible. Then we will move to the visible imagery, made, for example, with the Landsat satellite or with Aster. You see that there is some overlap between the techniques. And then at the end, we will move to ultraviolet spectrometry, which has been developed not for the volcanoes. It has been developed for the monitoring of the ozone around Earth and for other things, but basically for the ozone. But you will see that it can be used also for volcanoes. So we will start here. C and L band radar. So as Francesco has said before, yesterday, the space agencies have developed many radar instruments in the last two decades. And hopefully, this will continue. We know that Sentinel-1 is almost ready to be launched, I hope. And I'm sure it will continue. So we have many satellites. And this sometimes very big, like this. Here you see Envisat satellite. So it's like a track. Here you see the two operators that give the scale. And what you have to remember about those satellites and the sensors on board, the radar sensors on board, is that today we have three different kinds of radar sensors. We have C-band instruments with wavelengths of about 6 centimeters. This is the most common instrument. And in the case of this instrument, if you get vegetation on ground, you will not cross very easily the vegetation. So the your signal will be of good quality only on a non-vegetated area on cities. And if you're on forest, it will not be so good. You will see in the examples. Then you have L-band instruments with longer wavelengths. And when you have a longer wavelength, it crosses easier the vegetation and you reach the surface. So I will see later an example of ALOS data in which you will see that the quality of the interferon is better in vegetated areas. And in the last years, two satellites or more, because of COSMO there are more satellites, have been launched to with X-band radar. And in this case, you don't cross the vegetation at all. Here, you have two examples of interferograms obtained on a volcano with one image before an eruption and one image after the eruption. So it is the same story as before. What you see here, so here, for example, in Piton de la Fournaise volcano, this is in July 2006, an eruption took place here in the south side of the volcano, so here on this side of the volcano. And this is the interferogram that was produced combining one image before the eruption and one after the eruption. In the previous talk, you have seen that the fringes were topographic fringes, and that to get the signal of movement on the glacier, you had to remove the topography. Here, we did exactly the same. We removed the topography, so what remains is the ground deformation. And the one fringe here corresponds to about 3 centimeters of deformation. We have maybe 12 fringes. So here at the center of the fringe pattern, we have a ground motion of something like 40 centimeters. This is the same thing on the Fernandina volcano in Galapagos. I'm showing Fernandina volcano because I will show it again later, just because it is in eruption today. And so you will see data from other satellites. But this is the situation during the previous eruption in 1995. With the ERS-1 satellite, colleagues from the Iceland and the US were able to produce an interferogram for that eruption. Again, fringes. Here, the scale of the image is something like 6 per 5 kilometers. And what you see here is what we call a model. Once we have fringes, this is the measurement. And then we need to make some theory to pass from the observations to what occurred in the ground. So what we have behind this model is a very simple theory. We say that the Earth is an elastic medium. And inside the Earth, we will take a rectangle, a very simple rectangle, and we open it like this. And we make the assumption that the medium is just a half space, elastic half space. So we have very few parameters. We have the opening. We have some elastic parameters that describe the medium. And then we have the length of the what we call the dike, or the opening, and then the width of the opening and the amount of opening. And here, what we did is, with this model was made to fit the data as best as we could, and we were able with this model to say, look, this fringe pattern is due to a dike which is 4 kilometers long, 2 kilometers deep, with an opening of 90 centimeters. So with this kind of observation from space, we are able to determine the size and the opening of a dike inside the Earth. In the case of Etna, you will see Etna longer this afternoon during the exercise, we were able to see many things. We were able to see fringes like those I showed before, but less visible because of the vegetation. We were able to see faults moving around the city of Catania. And also, since last year, we were able to develop interferograms using the ALOS satellite in L-band. And you can see that with this satellite, in this part of this part of the volcano, which is very much vegetated, here we cannot see any signal, but with ALOS we see a discontinuity, and this discontinuity corresponds to a fault, which is moving all the time, 2 centimeters per year, And the interferogram shows us very well the motion across the fault. So we move now to the infrared. So what I will show you later is results obtained with the MODIS sensor on board of a NASA satellite, sampling across the in the infrared and visible band. You will have more detail this afternoon about this during the exercise. Here is just to show you that with when you have more bands, depending which band you are going to use, you will see one feature or another feature. So for example, here it's in two colors, so with the visible band, we see Etna with snow on it. And in here there is the volcanic plume, but you cannot distinguish the plume from the snow. While when you use a different band, when you use a band in the infrared, you can distinguish snow from the plume because the temperature of the plume is higher than the temperature of the snow. So we go back to Alaska, and so Anchorage is here with the airport, and here is Redoubt volcano, a very big volcano, 3 kilometers high. And this photo was taken 5 days ago on the 16th of April. This volcano is currently in eruption. And this is a MODIS image taken on the 5th of April this year. Here you see the volcano, here you see the plume, and here you see ash deposit, and here you see mud flow in a valley. Anchorage is there. And this is the same thing, but now with using bands in the infrared. So again, you see the volcano, but you see the plume a little bit better, and still you see the deposits of ash and mud around the volcano. And this is an image taken 5 days ago. The snow is melting in Alaska, but it has been snowing on the volcano. We see less well the ash on the volcano, but we see a little bit. And this is a photo that was taken in the same day, on the 16th of April, in the ground, in this valley. So what you see from space here is the mud flow, and here you see the mud flow in the ground. And this is the same thing in the infrared. We move now to visible. In fact, it's not exactly just visible, it's also partly infrared. With Landsat imagery, this afternoon you are going to play with Landsat imagery, I think. So those are two examples, one on Etna in 2001 during an eruption. So the visible imagery can be used first to look at the evolution of the vegetation on a volcano during years. Here you have 7 years of observation at Pinatubo volcano, and in red you see the vegetation that reappears on the volcano. And this is important. It is important for many things, including volcanological issues, like the prediction of places where you can have landslides triggered during rain. Because the vegetation will stabilize the ground, and the number of landslides will decrease with time after a big eruption. OK, this is an image of the MODIS instrument on the 11th April at Fernandina volcano in the Galapagos, the day when an eruption started. And this is the situation 2 days ago, again measured with the MODIS instrument on board of Terra. So in fact, here you have the address of a website where all those the data from MODIS on volcanoes are gathered, and you can follow the activity day by day on many volcanoes on Earth. I move to my last slides concerning ultraviolet on the volcanoes. So the ultraviolet is, as I said before, is with higher frequency, shorter wavelength, and it will not cross easily the lower atmosphere. So what you will sample is the upper atmosphere and stratosphere. So for small eruptions, you will see nothing. You need big eruptions to see volcanic plume, and then maybe you will be able to quantify the volcanic plume. So this is an example of the last satellite launched by the NASA for doing this kind of observation, and this is the instrument on board. And here you have an example of measurements made by this satellite, so the OME on board of Aura, last week on the 14th of April. And what you see here still is Fernandina volcano in the Galapagos, and here we have a measurement of the quantity of sulfur dioxide emitted by this volcano. So this is from last week, and every day or every 2 days we have the same kind of measurement with this satellite. This is another example obtained on Etna by the GOME instrument on board of ERS2. Finally, during very big eruptions, the ash going in the stratosphere can remain in the stratosphere not during hours, but during days, weeks, or years. And this has been the case in many times in the past. And in the last decades, we have two situations like that. One is the El Chichon eruption in Mexico in 1982. And the most important case was the eruption of Pinatubo in 1991. And here, you see the plume of Pinatubo that is very big and has been stayed around Earth for weeks. And here, what you see is the same as we have seen in the previous slide. You have the quantity of sulfur dioxide in the plume measured with ultraviolet device that was operated at that time. So that's the end of my talk. Thank you very much for your attention.